ධම්මං සරණං ගච්ඡාමි සංඝං සරණං ගච්ඡාමි අරියං වෝ භික්ඛවේ සම්මා සමාධින් දේශිසාමි ස උපනිසං ස පරිකාරං Monks, I shall teach you the noble right concentration with its support and requisites. Friends, this is how the Buddha taught us noble right concentration. Concentration here means stillness. That is normally the familiar term is stillness. So today for this Dhamma talk, the given topic is the path to stillness, that is path to concentration. So let's understand what concentration is, what stillness is. Stillness has different synonyms, such as calmness, peacefulness, tranquility, or serenity. These are synonyms. Stillness is basically twofold. Stillness of body and stillness of mind. It is easy to keep the body still. Everybody can do that. Stillness of body. What is difficult is stillness of mind. This mind is called monkey mind. This mind has been compared to a crocodile. It's very agitated, distracted, disturbed, confused. This mind is very difficult to guard. Buddha himself said this. In the Dhammapada, the Buddha said, Pandanang chapalang chitta. Chitta means mind. This mind is pandana. Pandana means fickle mind. Pandanang chapalang. Chapalang. Pandana, flickering fickle mind. Pandanang chapalang chitta. Durakkhang. It is difficult to rakha, difficult to protect. God, durakkhang, dunnivarayang, is difficult to cover, dunnivarayang. Ujung karoti medhavi, it is the wise who strengthens this mind. So the wise people can do this. That means, though it is difficult, it is possible to control this mind, to guard this mind. On another occasion, the Buddha said, Varijova tale kitto, oka mokata ubhato. This mind, as if a fish is drawn out of the water and cast on the land, is flickering, is troubled, and it waves. This is the nature of mind. It's faring far. This mind. Durang gamang. Eka charang lives alone. This is the nature. So this mind is to be understood. Can the animal do this? Can the hungry ghost do this? Can the other beings do this? Humans. Only humans have this opportunity, because humans' mind is a developed mind which can be further developed. Therefore, as humans, we have to start this. We have to continue this. We have to complete this. We have to develop our own mind. It is possible, the Buddha said. So to control this mind, the way is stillness. Way is stillness. First the stillness of this body, then the stillness of mind. Stillness, the Pali term for stillness is samatha or samadhi. When you come to the state of tranquility, calmness, stillness, that is called samadhi. You come to samadhi. Friends, as the mind is agitated, mind is defiled. Our mind is defiled, it is agitated. Since it is defiled, it is agitated. Since it is agitated, it is defiled. This is the problem. Buddha said, Chitta sankilesa bhikkhave satta sankilisante. Monks, these beings, satta means beings, these beings are defiled when the mind is defiled. When the mind is defiled, beings are defiled. Whenever we see a person doing something wrong, it is not because of his body, but because of his mind. When the mind is defiled, the person is defiled. Chitta sankilesa bhikkave satta sankilesanti. And on the other hand, chitta vodana satta visujjanti. When the mind is purified, beings are purified. That is the nature. So mind is the problem here. Because mind is the vital energy within. Within and without. Internal and external, both. Mind is the fastest energy. It is the vital energy. The so-called man, woman means six elements. Earth, water, fire, air, space, and consciousness. Consciousness. This consciousness is to be understood. The Buddha said, this consciousness is to be understood. How to understand this consciousness? Our consciousness, our chitta, it is difficult to understand because it has different aspects, different facets of mind. In order to understand this, the Buddha used three different terms. Chitta, mano, vijnana. These are the three terms. When the mind is connected to heart, it is called chitta, which is the emotional aspect of mind. When the mind is connected to our brain, it is called mano, which is the intellectual aspect of mind. When the mind is connected to our senses, it is called consciousness or vijnana. Vijnana, which is the perceptional aspect of mind. So there are three aspects of mind. You have to understand this mind in this manner. There are no tools to understand this mind. You can't see this mind. Therefore Buddha said, sududdhasang. It is very difficult to see. Sunipunang. It is so sharp. So subtle, this mind. Sududdhasang. Sunipunang. Yatta kama nipatinang. It drops wherever it likes, not what we like. But it likes the mind, wherever the mind wants, it drops there, shifts there, wherever it likes. Yatta kama nipatinam chittassa damato sadhu. The Buddha said, chittassa damato sadhu. It is good that you train this mind, control this mind, guard this mind, tame this mind. It's good. Chittang dantang sukavahang. The tamed mind brings happiness. That is the reason. So to train this mind, to cleanse this mind, purify this mind, there are many different teachers even before the Buddha. Many sages taught different methods to come to the state of stillness, samatha. As you all know, even before the Buddha, thousands of people, Brahmins, they attain different jhana. They started practice. First jhana, second jhana, third jhana, fourth jhana. Then they practiced infinity of space, infinity of consciousness, nothingness, neither perception nor non-perception. All these are called different jhana and attainment. After that, they practice, develop, they gain different types of knowledge, such as ability to read their previous lives, or miraculous power, reading others' mind, understanding how beings are born to this world, how they depart here and are born somewhere else, and listening to the sounds far, near, humans or divine. These are different types of knowledge. They gain all these things. There are five types of knowledge. These are called pancha abhinya. Abhinya. Abhinya means knowledge. High knowledge. Five higher knowledge. They gain these knowledges. Different types of knowledge they gain. Pancha abhinya. And jhana. First four jhana are called material jhana or worldly jhana. Material jhana. First, second, third, and the fourth are called material jhana. Then they gain attainment, which are called immaterial jhana. With all this, they maintain their stillness, calmness. It is because of stillness, calmness, tranquility of mind, they gain these different types of knowledge, but no enlightenment. No enlightenment, though they develop all this, no enlightenment, no eradication of defilement, no way. The Buddha wanted to understand differently. Since the Buddha understood that it was not the way, as he practiced, you know, he practiced when he was very young, under a rose apple tree. He practiced this jhana. He practiced the first jhana, attained first jhana. He had no time, and the environment was not properly conducive to him to continue his meditation. He only practiced up to the first jhana. And thereafter, after his great renunciation, he went forth, he went to meet different teachers like Alara Kalama and Uddaka Ramaputta. When he went to Alara Kalama, he was taught how to practice this jhana. The first jhana, the second jhana, third jhana, fourth jhana, and then the attainments, the infinity of space, infinity of consciousness and nothingness. This was taught by Alara Kalama and Uddhaka Ramaputta. So Alara Kalama taught him the first six types of jhana attainment. And at the end he went to meet Alara Kalama and he reported what his experience was. Then he said that that is only what he knew, Alara Kalama. Thereafter he been quite disgusted. He went away. He met another teacher, Uddhaka Ramaputta, where he was taught another one, which is called neither perception nor non-perception. Then he got all these things, and finally he understood that this is not the way to eradicate defilement. This is not the way to attain enlightenment. This is not the way to liberation, complete liberation. Therefore, he practiced his own. He gave up all these things. And he practiced severe austerities for 6 years. Finally, he came to the Bodhi tree. Under the Bodhi tree, he practiced. He understood that it is the same way that he practiced when he was young. He wanted to continue this, and he started and practiced. Eventually, he understood the real way of practicing jhana, the way to stillness. The real way to come to stillness, that is the Buddhist way to come to stillness. The Buddha said in the discourses, Buddha very clearly said how to come to stillness. What is to be done first? Buddha said, quite secluded from sensual pleasures. Vivicheva kamehi. That is the first thing to be done. You have to be aloof from kama, sensual pleasures, sexual pleasures. That is the first thing to be done. In order to attain this jhana, the stillness, aloof, secluded from sensual pleasures. Vivicheva kamehi. Then secondly, vivicha akusalehi dammehi. Ekusala. What is ekusala? Akusala. Unwholesome. Completely cut off. Unwholesome deeds. What are unwholesome? Killing is unwholesome. Stealing is unwholesome. Sexual misconduct is unwholesome. False speech is unwholesome. Malicious speech is unwholesome. Harsh speech is unwholesome. Frivolous talk is unwholesome. Covetousness is unwholesome. Ill will is unwholesome. Wrong view is unwholesome. Avoid wrong view. Then where you end up? Right view. You come to right view. Your view is right. Your view is quite, as I said the other day, the panoramic view. It is understanding, not simply a view, but you come to a right understanding where you can understand the four noble truths. When you understand these four noble truths as theory, not in deeper sense, though though you understand these four noble truths. Now you are practicing vivichcha kusalehi dhammehi. Then you are, while you are meditating, you are developing, you have your vitakka. Vitakka is sustained thought. First you have applied thought or thinking. To apply your thinking of the object. That is called thinking. Then you examine it. Vichara. Savitakkang, savicharang. Viveka jam, as you have seclusion, detachment. Viveka jam, born with that seclusion, that detachment, you can come to the first jhana. Patama jhanang upasampajya viharati. That is how one has to come to first jhana. Then as the second one, you don't want to think of it again and again. You have no discursive thought. That means you drop vitakka and vichara. Vitakka vicharanang vupasama. Having dropped vitakka and vichara. Avitakkang avicharang samadhijang. Now you have samadhi. You have stillness mind. Calmness mind. Samadhijang. Piti, you have piti, rapture. Sukhang, happiness, you have happiness as well. Piti sukhang. Dutiya jhanang upasampajya virati, you can enter the second jhana. Then you can drop piti, no more piti, there's nothing to be experience rapture. No piti, drop piti again. Pitiyacha viraga upikha. Now you have equanimous mind. Your mind is equanimity. Equanimous mind. Upikha kocha viharati, where you have satto and sampajano, which is not found in any other faith. Earlier the Buddha. There were many methods of practice in samatha, stillness, but they had no these two things. What are the two things? Mindfulness and clear comprehension. Satto and sampajano was absent. Now the Buddha understood these two. It is necessary to keep persistently keep this mindfulness, so that you can see it clearly. Sampajano. You know it very well. That is very important in jhana. You have to understand. You should know very well. You should know it clearly. What you are doing. It is not a dream. Jhana is not a dream. So, satocha sampajano. That is how you come to the third jhana. And then, both, you abandon both somanasa, domanasa, happiness and unhappiness, both. You give up both and come to the fourth jhana. Sukhasa cha pahana, dukkhasa cha pahana. Abandon sukha and dukkha both. Sukhasa cha pahana, dukkhasa cha pahana, pubbeva somanasa domanasanam atthagama. Having abandoned adukkam asukam upekkhako sati parisuddhim. His upekkha and sati both are parisuddhim, crystal clear and very purified mind, which is full of mindfulness and equanimity. With that you come to the fourth jhana. Friends, this is how the Buddha taught us to practice stillness. how to practice stillness, come to stillness. This is the path to stillness. When you practice in this manner, when you enter the fourth jhana, Buddha taught us it is possible to develop these five types of, gain these five types of knowledge, which were gained by other people also in other type of faith, even before the Buddha. But the Buddha pointed out something special, which is unique in the teaching of the Buddha. Buddha said, when you practice this, you can, after fourth jhana, you can further develop infinity of space, akasananchayatana, infinity of space, consciousness, vijnananchayatana, nothingness, neither akinchanyayatana, then neither perception nor non-perception, neva sanya nasanyayatana, and that is the end of other faith practice. Neva sanya nasanyayatana. Buddha said, you can do something more. What is that? You can enter enter a samadhi, which is called complete cessation of perception and feeling. Completely you cease your feeling and perception. That is called Nirodha Samapatti or Sanya Vedayata Nirodha. When you enter this particular attainment called Sanya Vedayata Nirodha or Nirodha Samapatti, you can stay, you can experience that bliss. Being sensitive to that bliss, you can remain for 7 days without any meal, any food or drinks, just like a dead body. You have no feeling, no perception, but you have your mind, your consciousness is there. You are not dead. Though you are sitting, you are not dead. But still, you can remain sitting for 7 days. When you come out of it, you experience Nibbana. That is the specialty. That is only in the teaching of the Buddha. That is one side, one aspect of developing this stillness. Secondly, under the same tree, the Buddha realized that it is not necessary to practice, gain these different types of knowledge, abhinya, but only not gain all these five different types of knowledge. But the Buddha realized something special, very special, a knowledge which is very special, unique in the teaching of the Buddha. What is that knowledge? This is given in the Bhaya Bhairava Sutta. Bhaya Bhairava Sutta, dread and fear. Fear and dread. Bhaya Bhairava, fear and dread. There is a sutta in the Majjhima Nikaya, middle length sayings. Buddha said how he practiced. While he was practicing, while he was meditating, his mind came to the state of calmness, stillness. As the mind is clear, bright, pure mind is wieldy, malleable, that mind, he directed his mind to understand his previous lives. Then he understood how he lived in the past. One life, two lives, three lives, 4, 5, 10, 20, 30, 50, 100, 1,000, 100,000, millions, trillions, eons of lives, how he lived in the past. he understood this. Because of the stillness of mind, calmness of this mind, as it is imperturbed, the mind is imperturbed. Aninjapatte, his mind is imperturbable mind. He realized this. That is a knowledge he gained. Then he directed his mind to understand how beings come to this world and how beings here depart and are born in some other realms. That is called Chuttupapata Jnana, or the ability to understand how beings are born to this world and how they depart here and are born somewhere else. That is the second knowledge he gained. So he said this clearly in the sutta. He gained the knowledge to understand his own previous lives. That is the first knowledge, which is called Pubbe Nivasa Anusati Jnana, if you want to know the Pali term. Secondly, he understood how beings are born to this world and how they depart here and are born otherwhere else. That is called Chuttupapata Jnana. The third one is the special one, which is unique. Nowhere else you can understand, nowhere else you can see this knowledge. Though thousands of people practice, develop their mind, develop their stillness, they couldn't understand this. Only Buddha understood this. What is that? That is called Asavakkhaya Jnana. Asava, what is asava? Asava means taints. Taints, very subtle defilements are called taints, asava. Asavakkhaya means destroying. Destroying defilements, destroying all taints. That is the knowledge to destroy all taints, completely destroying of all taints. That knowledge, Buddha realized that knowledge. So friends, this is how the Buddha taught us. This is how we see the difference. Buddha's teaching is completely a different one from that of others. We should not compare Buddhism with other religions and say we all are the same. Don't put Buddhism into the same basket. See Buddhism as Buddhism if you want to understand Buddhism. Never compare Buddhism with other religions and say that every religion teaches the same thing. Why? Can you see Four Noble Truths in other religions? Can you see the dependent origination in other religions? Can you see the three characteristics of existence in other religions? Then what? Why say? Some people say, same. What same? Buddha's teaching is unique. It is unique. You have to understand that uniqueness of this teaching. And other religions, they have their own uniqueness. Let them to keep them as they are. That is how we have to understand religions. We should not put all religions into the same basket and say we all are the same. So the Buddha taught us this Dhamma. When you practice this Dhamma, you can gain these three types of knowledge. You can read your own previous lives. You can understand. Even for some extent, you can't do that as the Buddha did. But you can understand your own previous lives, where you came here. Maybe several lifetimes, how you were born, how you lived in the past. You can understand it yourself with your stillness. And then you can understand how beings come to this world and how they depart here and are born somewhere else. And the specialty is that you can eradicate your own defilements. own tents, asava. For this purpose, the Buddha taught us a way, a path. That path is called middle path, middle way, which consists with 8 factors. You all know these factors. Right understanding, samadhi, right intention, samasankappa, right speech, samavacha, right action, samakammanta, right livelihood, samajiva, right effort, samavayama, right mindfulness, samasati, right concentration, samasamadhi. Those are the 7-8 factors, 8 factors of the path, which is called 8 noble eightfold path. These are called noble because the noblest one discovered, rediscovered this. And also because when you practice, develop this, you yourself can become a noble one. Here, this path, noble eightfold path, is divided into 3 groups: Sila, Samadhi, Panya. Sila, Samadhi, Panya are the 3 groups of the path. These eight are put into these 3 groups. Of the 3, Samadhi group, when you say Samadhi, that is what is called stillness. Samadhi group has 3 factors: effort, right effort, right mindfulness, and right concentration. Without effort, you can gain nothing. Effort is very much significant, very much important in our practice. Effort is to be made in 4 things. First, the effort is to be made to restrain ourselves. Sangvarapahanam. For the purpose of restrain. Sangvarapadhanam. Sangvarapadana. Padana means striving. Striving is to be made to restrain ourselves. Secondly, pahanapadanam. Pahana is to avoid unwholesome. Bhavanapradana. Third, bhavanapradana. Bhavanapradana. Bhavana is develop. Develop wholesome. In order to develop wholesome thoughts, that is meditation. That is bhavana. You have to make effort to develop wholesome thoughts. Skillful thoughts. Kusala. Then, anurakkhana padanam. Anurakkhana is to maintain the same thing. Those are the 4 things which are called 4 effort, 4 strivings. With this effort, we have to practice our meditation. That is how we come to stillness. When we practice in this manner, we practice right mindfulness. Right mindfulness is the 4 foundations of mindfulness. 4 foundations of mindfulness. Then come to right concentration. Right concentration, even again I should say, right concentration can be found here only. Buddha very clearly said this, friends, even his last days, just before his passing away, he said, the first samana means the stream enterer, the second samana means the once returner, third samana means non returner, The Arahant can be seen only in this sasana. The Buddha said, why? Because in other sasana you don't find this path. You don't find this path. You don't find right concentration. Right stillness is void. What do you call right stillness then? Buddha's teaching is not simply the path to stillness, but we have to put it the path to right stillness. So to say, right stillness. What is right stillness? That is what I said at the very beginning of this talk. I quoted from the Buddha's very word, from Mahachattarisaka Sutta, the great 40. Buddha said, Ariyangvo bhikkave samma samadhin. That is the samadhi. Samma samadhi, which is Aryang, noble. Monks, I shall teach you the noble right concentration, right stillness. What is that right stillness? Right stillness can be gained. Please keep this in your mind. Right stillness can be gained only with the support of the first seven factors of the path. Without the seven factors of the path, you can gain stillness. Just like you still your body. You can just calm down, but it is not the right stillness. It is not the right concentration. Because if you have no right understanding, no right concentration. If you have no right intention, no right concentration, right stillness. If you have no right speech, no right stillness. If you have no right action, no right concentration, stillness. If you have no right living, no right concentration. If you have no right effort, no right concentration, no right stillness. If you have no right mindfulness, no right concentration. Right concentration, noble right concentration can be gained only through the support of the first seven factors of the path. That is to be understood. This is why the Buddha said, practice samadhi, practice stillness. Stillness is fourfold. Stillness leads to peaceful abiding here. That is one type of stillness. Secondly, stillness leads to knowledge and vision. Third, stillness leads to mindfulness and clear comprehension. Fourth, stillness leads to complete destruction of all taints. Four types of stillness. Buddha said, Samadhin bhikkhave bhaveta, monks, practice stillness. Practice bhaveta, develop stillness, concentration. When the mind is stilled, when the mind is concentrated, yatha bhutang pajanati, you can see things as they are. Friends, now it is clear, stillness is not enough. Stillness is not the end of the teaching of the Buddha. Buddha taught us something more. Being still, what you have to do? You have to see through, you have to penetrate the object. You have to understand things as they are. That is what is called vipassana, insight. Stillness should lead to insight. When you have stilled mind, concentrated mind, that mind can see through. Samahito bhikkhu yatha bhutam pajanati. Kincha yatha bhutam pajanati. Buddha questioned, What can you see as they are? Rupasya samudayancha atthagamancha. You can see the origination and cessation of this body. Samudayancha vedana, vedanaya, vedana, the feeling. You can see the origination of feeling, cessation of feeling. You can see the origination of perception and the cessation of perception. You can see the origination of formation and the cessation of formations. You can see the origination of your consciousness and the cessation of consciousness. Rupa, Vedana, Sanya, Sankara, Vijnana, five aggregates. You can see these five aggregates as they are Yatha Buddha. And furthermore, the Buddha said, you can see Dukkha as Dukkha. The origination of Dukkha as the origination of Dukkha. Cessation of Dukkha as the cessation of Dukkha. And the path leading to the cessation of Dukkha as the path leading to the cessation of Dukkha. The Four Noble Truths. That means you can realize the Four Noble Truths. If you realize the Four Noble Truths, you realize Dhamma. You are the liberated one. Your mind is liberated. Then you yourself can say, it is liberated. It is liberated. What is liberated? Mind is liberated. Then you yourself say that birth is destroyed. Hereafter I will not be born again. Kina jati. Vusitam brahmacharyam. I led the holy life. Khatam karaniyan. Done what had to be done. Naparan nithattayati. I will never be born again here. You yourself can understand this. Being the arahant, the enlightened one. Friends, this is the purpose of our life. This is the purpose of practicing this wonderful teaching. Let's all understand this teaching and practice this teaching so that one day we also can attain this wonderful state of calmness, peacefulness, stillness and complete release, complete liberation of all defilements and attain supreme bliss of Nibbana. May we all attain supreme bliss of Nibbana.
Sadhu, sadhu,
sadhu, sadhu.
Thank you, Venerable Siddhananda. And we would like to open question and answer. Is there anybody who would like to ask question to Bhante? Please raise your hand.
Only we have 8 minutes, huh?
Thank you, Bhante. My question to you would be with regards to consciousness. You mentioned about three parts, the citta, the mano, and the vijnana. Of the three parts, which would be the most difficult to gain insight into? Would it be the citta, because it deals with feelings? And my second question is, when we aspire, we tend to aspire to be a non-returner. However, you mentioned that in this asana, this is the only way where we can practice the Eightfold Path. So should our aspirations to be reborn in a human realm rather than to be a non-returner? Thank you.
Chitta is three aspects. I said about three aspects. Of the three, the chitta is the most gross form. Gross form means it is the emotional part, emotional aspect, which is difficult to understand even. When we have emotions, suppose we have fear, we cannot understand our mind at the moment. We have fear, it is emotional. That is why I said that it is the gross part, chitta. To be born here as a human, if we aspire to attain non-ritana, the state of non-ritana, so all these different stages can be gained while we are practicing here, while we are living here in this very world. So if we aspire, simply our aspiration is not enough, we have to practice. When we practice, if we practice, we can experience these different stages of the holy life. Is that your question? Which one is better?
From what your talk mentioned, that only in this human realm that we can practice the eight path. So would it mean that we then should aspire to be reborn as a human being?
No, I did not say that only in this world you can practice Noble Eightfold Path. I said only in this faith, this teaching. Only in this teaching there is Noble Eightfold Path. That is what I said. Okay? Clear? Not nowhere else you can see this Noble Eightfold Path, which completes with another two factors, so that the path will become tenfold path, which is unique in this teaching.
Brother and sister, I would like to close the question and answer because Pante has to go for having lunch.
Okay, let's share merit with departed ones. May all our dearly departed relatives rejoice this merit. May all our friends, may all beings rejoice this merit. By the power of all this merit, may we all attain supreme bliss of Nibbana. With that good thought, let's recite the stanza to share merit with departed ones. Idam me nyate nang hotu sukhita hontu nyate. Idam me nyate nang hotu sukhita hontu nyate. Idam me nyate nang hotu sukhita hontu nyate. May all deities rejoice this merit. May all beings rejoice this merit. By the power of all this merit, may we all attain supreme bliss of Nibbana. Please recite the stanza. Itta vita ca amhehi sambhataṃ punya sampada. Sabbe deva anumodaṃ tu sabba sampatti siddhya. Itta vata ca amhehi sambhataṃ punya sampada. Sabbe bhuta anumodaṃ tu sabba sampatti siddhya. Itta vata ca amhehi sambhataṃ punya sampada. Sabbe satta anumodaṃ tu sabbe sampatti siddhya. Sadhu, sadhu, sadhu. Thank you.
Let's give three bows to Venerable Siddhananda.
Sukhi hoto, sukhi hoto, sukhi hoto.